incredibly talented people. Here's the neatest part about this. If you take the core of this company, there was a handful of us. There were four or five of us that used to, you know, have our beer and pizza every Friday night, and that was our meetings in the hangar. And today, you've got a company with over 700 people working here, and this is a company that has over 250-plus aircraft that flies more than the U.S. Army, and better than 98% of those people. When you look at who these people are that are flying our aircraft, that are managing our aircraft, they all started where you are. They started off, they came into a seminar, and they used to be something besides that. Right? They were driving buses and trucks, they were firemen, they were police officers, they were construction workers, they were working in the computer industry, they were doing something else. And what's interesting is if you talk to those people today, they will tell you that it wasn't a lifelong dream. It wasn't that since I was that big, all I ever wanted to be was a helicopter pilot. It was that as I became an adult, what most of our students would tell you, who are now our employees, is when they became an adult and they started living life, there's a lot to that, for those of you that understand this. It means you gotta get up every morning and go to work. And you work your 5 days a week, or your 6 days a week for some of you, and you got bills to pay, and families to raise, and obligations, and you do this for years. But you find yourself sometimes, after years of doing this, that you've lost something. And that's the passion that you once had for the work part of your life, the business side of your life. And there's something that was said to me a long time ago, and it really makes sense. And that is, passion is not lost, it's abandoned. It's not lost, it's abandoned. Think about that. It's simply that there comes a time in your life where you just say, that's just not going to be real for me. I'm going to be doing this for a long, long time. This is an opportunity for people to do something that is truly, I believe, the best profession in the world. I mean, think about it for a minute. You go out and fly a helicopter every day and get paid for it. That's a smoking deal, right? I think the true definition of success in business is if you could find something that you would do for free and then figure out a way to get paid for it, that would be a definition of success, wouldn't it? And when you talk to people who work for this company, they'll tell you that that's where their success is. We have good compensation, it's a good company, we stay very busy, and we are always in need of more people and expansion. So I'm gonna tell you a little bit of history about how we got here, and it'll help you understand what some of our reasoning or thinking is in going forward. And you heard some of it in the presentation here a little while ago with the Heartbeat of America TV show. But this started off right out of high school. I went to work, I was 17 years old, and went to work for a company down in Southern California. And by the time I was 19 years old, I had, not only did I have three children, but I was a national manager for a company. And it was something that came natural for me. Business and management was something that was very easy for me. Not a passion for me, but something that was easy for me. I had a passion, and that was law enforcement. I'd always wanted to be a police officer. My grandfather was the sheriff of the county that I grew up in, and I thought, well, that's just the coolest job in the world. And finally, when I was 25 years old, I made a decision that I was going to do what I wanted to do in my life, and I was going to follow that passion, and I did. And I had been very successful as a business, as a manager of business, as a national manager for a major company that was a two-time Inc. 500 company. But I walked away from that to become a police officer, and I'll tell you what, I loved the job. I truly used to drive to work every day and think, I cannot believe that people pay me for this. And I got involved in law enforcement for all the right reasons. I wanted to be able to drive fast, carry a gun, and kick people's ass. Yeah, I mean, save the world thing too, but what I say is, I got involved in the right reasons because it was my personal passion. I really wanted it. I thought that was a great job. It was an adrenaline job. It was something that I could be proud of, and I could be excited about. Every day was different. In 1995, I came a point in my life where I had a decision to make. By this time, I had been divorced and remarried. I had a pretty good-sized family and a pretty good-sized debt. And I had an opportunity to move to Las Vegas and open up my own company again. And by now, I had spent everything I'd ever made. And as a police officer, I wasn't making enough. I really wasn't. I was working more than one job. And so a manufacturing company, offered me the opportunity to have my own company. All I had to do was come up with $40,000. And that was only about $39,900 more than I had. So I borrowed the money, and literally half of it on handshake, and the other half on the house. And I moved to Las Vegas, I opened a business. And in a very short amount of time, that was July of 1995, by 1997, it was the largest company in the United States at its time, which is environmental products, water purification products. In 1999, I sold my company. I sold it because somebody offered me way too much money for it. And I didn't, and again, I never had a passion. I liked the fact that I built a business. We had, you know, several hundred people working in the company. It was a great business. But I never once got up in the morning and said, geez, today, I hope I can, you know, land an account at a casino or go design a new water system for whoever. I never had that. I was happy that I was being successful and I was able to have a nice house and provide for my family, but the passion was gone. And I was constantly always thinking about my past career in law enforcement. I even stayed as a reserve deputy sheriff just so I could keep my standings and go back once in a while and get to enjoy this, you know, legal compensation. But when I, but in 99, now back up just a little bit, 1996, when I had my business before I sold it, there was something that I'd always thought would be interesting, and that would be to fly a helicopter. As a matter of fact, before I joined the police academy, in Stockton, California, I said, there's two things that I would do for a career that I truly would love, be a helicopter pilot or be a police officer. The first thing I looked at was being a helicopter pilot. And here's what I found out. This is back in the 1980s. When I went to Stockton and I met a guy there, he had a helicopter and you could pay him to take lessons. And I said, I think it'd be neat to do this for a living. He said, it's not going to happen. You had to have 3,500 hours of experience before anybody would hire you. Now think about this, even at that time, you would have to rent the helicopter, which was costing $150 to $200 an hour, and then you got to, and that includes the pilot support too, but then you got to buy the books and do all the study and so forth, and you had to have 3,500 hours. Well, every 1,000 hours is $200,000, isn't it? Right? I didn't have an extra $600,000 or $700,000 to spend so that I could go make $40,000 a year. So it became unrealistic. I would have to compete with all of the pilots that the military produced during the Vietnam era. And they were producing at one time 600 to 800 pilots a month during that era. And those pilots came right back into the civilian market. They owned the market. So I went to law enforcement instead. But in 1996, you flash forward, I had some success in my business in Las Vegas. So I thought, I'm going to take lessons. I'm going to learn to fly a helicopter just as a hobby. And I went down to the airport, and they had a guy who had a 1966 Hughes 269. Which is an old military training helicopter. And at the time, I was pretty excited about it. I wouldn't fly it today because I know too much. But at the time, I thought it was pretty cool. And the way it worked is you rent the helicopter from one guy, then you hire another guy who worked at the canyon on his days off. He was a flight instructor, and he'd teach you. And you know, they tell you, before you leave, you have to wash the helicopter and the blades. The student does. I'm out there doing it. So that's what you have to do. And it is, by the way, for all of you who become students. It was an experience and I loved it. I truly loved it. And in 99, when I sold my business, I thought, well, wouldn't it be cool to buy my own helicopter now? So I did. It was myself and three other guys that were all taking lessons from the same guy in Vegas. We all used to rent this old Hughes helicopter. And we all sat down and said, well, why don't we all just pitch in and buy a helicopter? So what we did was we each put in, I think, $7,500 a piece for the down payment. And we opened up a company, Silver State Helicopters. We ordered our first Robinson R-22 helicopter, which is one of these helicopters that's set up here in the front. That's what it looked like, okay? And so now we've got this helicopter. It came in early 2000, and I started flying this helicopter. Now, I had sold my business. These other guys were still working. So these guys were continuing, you know, I had to fly all the time. These guys didn't. So over the next year, actually 2 years, from about when we got delivered in March of 2000 until about Thanksgiving of 2001, I was flying so much that I ended up buying their shares of the company. So now I own a company called Silver State Helicopters. That company had one helicopter, a Robinson R-22 helicopter. And here was my thinking. I had told my wife when I first, because you have to justify this stuff to your wife, right? These small helicopters are $200,000 a piece, so they're expensive. What I told my wife was, because I'd sold the business, I went back, I grew up on a cattle ranch in Northern California up by Yosemite. And I told my wife that if I had a helicopter, I could fly up to the ranch and develop the ranch. That I bought the ranch back from my relatives. Can you guys still hear me in the back, even with that airplane going by? Yes? Yeah, you can? Okay. So I bought this helicopter, and I take off. Now, if you're familiar with the state of California and the state of Nevada, in order to get from Las Vegas to Northern California, they have a mountain range in between called the Sierra Nevadas mountain range. And their mountain range is pretty hot. Well, these helicopters, they don't like to fly pretty high. And I found that out. I got up to about 12,000 feet trying to go over the top of these mountains. And I made a deal with God. And I said, if you'll let me live through this, I won't do that no more. So what I did was, and I thought we had a picture of it, but I built a trailer, and I put the helicopter on the trailer, and then I would tow the helicopter from my house 500 miles to the ranch, fly around the ranch, and tow it back. And that was that was the extent of Silver State Helicopters. Now, Thanksgiving came along, 2001. If you remember, 9/11 had just happened. And after 9/11 happened, aviation took this. All of a sudden, you could buy aircraft at a pretty reasonable cost. And so when that happened, a friend of mine called me and said, hey, I know a family that's in trouble financially. They've got an MD-500 helicopter. MD-500 looks like the picture that you see up there on the board, or like if you watch the movie, Tom Selleck, the Hawaii movie, FBI. That was an MD-500 that they had in that movie. I bought a helicopter like that, and I literally bought it sight unseen. But I thought, well, that would be really cool. And again, I convinced my wife that if I had that helicopter, I could fly back and forth over the mountains, which I really could. Here's where I got my surprise. When I bought that helicopter, I got a smoking deal on it, $475,000. And it would have been a great deal, but when I went to pick it up, it hadn't been flown for about 7 years. And I was very naive in this industry, and I didn't realize that if it hasn't been flown for 7 years, that means it has to go to a repair station first, a shop, and they have to make sure it's airworthy, and they started telling me about all the parts that had to be replaced. So, to give you an idea, the blades on this helicopter are about $20,000 a piece. There's five of them. The engine runs for a rebuild a little over $200,000. You know, little bitty things like this big that you can buy at Pep Boys, I'm sure, for $300 or $400, probably like $500, $600, and it needed a whole lot of this stuff. So what I had to do was figure out a way to justify the ownership of that helicopter. I didn't know how to fly it at MD-500, so I hired a Metro police officer named Tim Nelson, we call him Topper, to go to California and help me learn to fly this. And in our conversations about what I was going to do with it, he mentioned that I might want to check with the Sheriff's Department about doing drug data. So I did. I called the Calaveras County Sheriff's Office. I asked them if they could use helicopters, and they said they did. As a matter of fact, they are subsidized by the state. A lot of states give counties money to go eradicate marijuana. California called the CAMP program, or Cannabis Eradication Program. And the counties then use that money to hire helicopter companies to go look for the marijuana and so forth. So when I called my cousin, I said, well, tell me how this works. And he said, okay, here's how it works. Four times a year, we use a helicopter for typically a week at a time. And when we do this, we go out usually in January, and we look for where there's little leaves on the trees in January. So we look for the areas where they grew marijuana the previous year. And you'll find water lines, and you'll find the discarded camping areas where they camp and so forth. And once we know where the likely spots are to grow marijuana, then we'll go back in April or May, and we start looking for the plants in those areas. And if we identify the plants, then they set up surveillance on the plants. Now, for those of you that do this for a living, you already know how to grow marijuana, but for those of you who don't, which might be, around May, the marijuana is to the point where they're going to start harvesting it in the May or early June. So what we would do is if we hadn't already been harvested, then we would fly deputies in and land them in the middle of the marijuana fields, because there's booby traps around the fields. They cut into bundles, and we take the helicopter and lift those bundles up and take them, put them on a truck, and they take them out and incinerate them. So I said, well, that's a smoking thing. That means I get to work for the sheriff's office 4 weeks out of the year, right? And the weeks are split up. I said, what do you guys pay for that? He says, well, the guy in Sacramento charges us $585 an hour for the helicopter, and that's while it's flying. And then when it's not flying, he pays us, we have to pay one-third of that, the standby fee. So if you're sitting waiting for a deputy to eat lunch, he's still making one-third of that. And then they charge him what's called a ferry fee, which has nothing to do with your sexuality. It's the, I'm a good moment. I'll do that. And the ferry fee is to get the helicopter from where this guy's shop was in Sacramento back to Calaveras County. He makes them pay for that airtime. So it's a pretty good deal by the time he gets done. So I said, well, tell him what I'll do. This was the head of the narcotics task force that I was talking to, and a cousin of mine. I said, I'll give you the helicopter for $500 an hour flat. You don't pay any standby fees, you don't pay any ferry fees, you don't pay any of that stuff. Just flat $500 an hour if it flies. He said, come on down. So I went to the Calaveras County, and we started flying this contract. The first day I flew the contract, it was pretty cool stuff, it really was. Flying around in the foothills up there, and an MD-500 with a couple of deputies, and I got a phone call at the sheriff's office that afternoon when we got back. One of the other members of the task force, one of the other sheriff's offices, said, hey, why don't you come do ours? I go, sure. Because now I've got 8 weeks that I can work a year, right? 1 week here, 1 week there. That's a pretty cool deal. Well, if you understand how law enforcement works, task forces are formed when they take sheriff's departments from all over the area, and they all donate one deputy, and then all the police departments donate an officer, and they all form this task force to look for drugs. So by the third day that I was there, every department that was a member of that task force had called and said, you can do ours. That's a great deal, except this. It's only 52 weeks in a year. So if I would have done from 1 week to the next, first of all, my wife had no idea it had gone that long, so, but if I had done this every week, by the time I get to the counties at the end of the list, the marijuana has already been grown and cut and dried and smoked and, what do you look for? You know, you're looking for a completely different animal. So I bought him with a helicopter. And I hired that Metro police officer that I originally was talking to fly the turn, I hired him. Then we bought another one. So I had a Long Ranger and a Jet Ranger, and all of a sudden I was getting a variety of helicopters, and I thought, well, they've got to be able to transport people with some of them, got to have a hook on one. And what, by March of 2002, remember the first contract I ever did was January of 2002. By March of 2002, I had 13 helicopters. 13. Now, one of the 13 was the original helicopter that I bought, and three of the other 13 were also R-22s. Not that I wanted any more R-22s, I really didn't, but I had bought this flight school so I could have their building, and I ended up with their helicopter. So what the heck, I had over 4 R-22s on the flight school. That's the only training facility Silver State had. But here's what happened to us. By the time I got up to 13 helicopters, I had 9 pilots. That doesn't work. See, a helicopter, in order for a helicopter to actually make a profit, it needs to fly a lot. Somewhere in the area, depending on the helicopter, of 80 to 100 hours a month, it needs to be in the air so that you can make money doing it. You cannot physically put 13 helicopters in the air for 80 hours with 9 pilots. It can't happen. So I had to finally say, listen, I have to hire some more pilots. So I put an ad out on the internet, and we all over the place, obviously, and we decided we're going to take a day and just interview pilots. We had 19 people respond that were helicopter pilots. And some of them were, you know, they weren't commercial pilots, but they were going to be someday, but they had some flight time, so they just really didn't qualify. But out of that, I think there were 16 that qualified. They had the hours and experience. The first guy we interviewed was absolutely we sat and talked to this guy, and after about 5 minutes, you know, I was just like, this guy's an asshole. You know? I mean, he really was. And I don't know if he could fly a helicopter or not, because we haven't got that far. I just was like, I can't even imagine hiring somebody like this and having to come to work every day and be around him. So the next guy comes in, and they were obviously related. really, I mean, it's the same thing. And I'm like, well, maybe it's just something about helicopter pilots that I don't know. Here's what we ended up with. Out of all the people we interviewed, and actually there was a total of 16 or 17 we interviewed, a couple didn't show up, a couple weren't qualified, we hired one guy. And afterward, I'm going, you've got to be kidding me. And it wasn't, and some of them had bad records, they couldn't fly helicopters very well, but there was the biggest problem I ran into was just the attitude of the person. It was just not anybody you want working for you, right? Now, you guys all, where you work today, do you all have somebody that you work with that you think, why is this person here? Right? They brighten up the room when they leave. You know what I'm talking about? Okay, that person, in my book, when I talk about this other guy, that guy's an ass, that's what I'm talking about. That guy that just gives you that feeling of pity yourself. Right? If you don't have somebody that you work with like that, you ain't be that guy. Everybody else And so I thought, well, this isn't going to work. I got to have pilots. And I had this flight school. I had about 15 students in the flight school. And I went and talked to some of the students and said, you know, what are your goals? Most of them were business people that could afford to swipe a credit card and come fly for 2 hours. And they weren't going to be a professional helicopter pilot. It was a hobby for them. But a couple of them were interested. So then I thought, well, what I'll do is hold a public seminar. Now, this was the first time we ever did this. It was in March of 2002. We held a public seminar. I thought we had 30, 40 people show up. And then I make them the great deal, which is, I figured that if somebody really wanted to be a pilot, the biggest thing that's going to stop them is they couldn't afford it. That's fine. I'll teach you how to fly a helicopter, and then come to work for us, and then you can pay me back over time, and we'll stretch out over 20 years if you have to. That was the idea. We put a commercial out on the radio, and by a couple of days into it, we had like 300 people scheduled to come. And I was thinking, there's just no way. And we ran this ad for less than a week, and on a Wednesday night, we backed up traffic as far as you could see. We had to call in one of these party companies to bring in seats. And I had to go home and get my karaoke machine so people could hear me. And I stood in front of a group of people like I have today in awe, because I had no idea. And at that time I said, I can't believe this many people want to be helicopter pilots. And then I said, how many of you have never flown in a helicopter before? How many of you have never flown in a helicopter before? Big number. And I thought, well, how do you know you want to be a pilot? Well, you know, I knew I wanted to be a cop before I'd ever been a cop. I knew that that was something that I would be proud of, that I would love to get involved in and continue involved in, and that I'd never stop learning and never stop progressing and never stop changing. And this is what I had. It's a room full of people that have this. They have just a passion and excitement for something. And I made some big mistakes that day. Here's one of the big mistakes I made. When I stood in front of those people, I said, I'm looking for 18 to 24-year-olds, male or female, I don't care. Because I was thinking, if I can get somebody 18 to 24 years old, they were going to go to college in most cases, or go further their education. Well, those of you that have ever had an 18 to 24-year-old, or maybe been one, you understand that you can go to school, go to college, but 85% of people never graduate. And then another 80+% of people who graduate with a degree never use the degree. They work in a different field. So I'm thinking this would be something their parents would support this, because they come to work for us, we can teach them to fly a helicopter within less than a year and a half. They start off making over $50,000 a year. They have to be drug and alcohol tested. It's part of the deal. You've got to be on a consortium where they constantly have to call your name anytime to be drug and alcohol tested. Not a whole lot of colleges that practice that, right? So something that the parents could feel good. And then their son or daughter, they graduate the program, and in a very short amount of time, they're making good money. I thought, what a great thing. What we ended up with was the largest daycare center for 18 to 24-year-old kids. It was unbelievable. And again, how do you not see this coming? When you're 18, all you care about is getting out of the house, right? It's not about work ethic. You don't know what that is yet. It's not about doing the right thing and getting up early. As a matter of fact, our flight schools, we had to quit. We couldn't do classes on a Friday night because nobody showed up. And you couldn't do classes on or fly on Saturday morning because nobody was sober yet, right? It was crazy. You know, they got this freedom thing going on. But here's what happened that was great. On that seminar, that first night, I had a couple of guys come up to me. There was seven of them, actually. We brought 35 people in the first class. Seven of those people were much older than 18 to 24. As a matter of fact, the first guy approached me was 57 years old. And he said, hey, I know I don't fit your criteria, but I want to do this more than anything in the world. And I've worked hard, and I can make it, and I'll do whatever I got to do, and I can give you, you know, 10 years of super hard work. And we made an exception. I had another guy that was, as a matter of fact, is now a vice president for our company. That came in, and he was an IT manager for one of the casinos. He's here today. He was an IT manager for one of the casinos, and in his past life before that, he used to build racing boats. He said, God, same thing, I can just see me doing this for the rest of my life. Major job, I paid for him, but he said, I just want to do this, and I've already done all the right things for a long time. You know, bought the house, had the family, did all the things I was supposed to do, but God, I just want to do this. The seven guys that I made an exception for, every one of those men work for me today. And everyone in a management position, and everyone would be what I call a model student. See, because what I would have thought before, a model student is somebody who gets his private license at 40 hours, you know, and 150 hours to just complete all those requirements. Not one of those guys did that. But that's not what a model student is. A model student's a guy that from the day he came in as a student, he treats this company like it's his own. He treats those helicopters like they're his own. They go out there and wipe these helicopters down before and after they fly them. Right? They don't do anything. They make sure that they never hurt that ship. And they make sure that they, even the golf carts, you know, that we used to go back and forth, they take care of them, they add water to the batteries. They show up to class on time, they always get their work done, their study. And it is harder to teach somebody that's older the, what I call monkey skills, right? Moving all this, it's harder for them to learn. I'm okay with that. Because that's a skill that we can teach, even if it takes us longer. But I'll tell you, I can't take somebody, I don't care what their skills are here, monkey skills, I can't take somebody and teach them work ethic. Can't do it. I can't teach somebody to show up on time. I can't teach somebody to care about this company. I can't teach somebody to be passionate about this. I can't teach that. But I can sure find people that already have it and then teach them the skill. And we've proved this over and over and over again. We've trained thousands of people to fly helicopters. A lot of those people still work for us today. Some of those people work for other operators today. We've got agreements with other operators now where we do help them. The pilots go out, gain experience, where we bring the pilots back into some of our operations. It's a program that works, and it works really well. So, to flash forward to where we are today. Where we are today is we learn so much in growing this company that we get to apply when we come to a new area like this. Here's one of the things that we learned that's really awesome. When you come in and hire people from the community, you are part of the community overnight. So I could bring 100 pilots in here and 15, 20 helicopters, and I could do this huge advertising blitz, and we'd be a big helicopter company here in New York. So what? What have we really done? Well, as far as the economy goes, we maybe help out a little bit, people bought houses. But what if instead, I come in here and I take the patience that it takes, which is tough, to find 100 people or 50 people, whatever the community support, that are already here, that are already part of this community, and I train those people, and then I put those people to work for the company. Well, we are a grassroots company overnight, aren't we? I discovered that in Las Vegas because those first 35 students that I hired, there was about 12, 15 of those students who were really pillars, or a big part of the community, I should say. They've been there for years. I'm not from Las Vegas. I lived there in 95, and I pretty much kept it to myself. But I had people working for me. Same as followers. I had people working for me that were truly a part of the community in Las Vegas. And so, there were certain things I wanted to do in Las Vegas. I wanted to be able to fly a helicopter out of the Grand Canyon and land in the bottom of the canyon. Can't do that. Right? Moratorium, you can't do it anymore. The Indians won't allow you to land up there, the Park Service won't let you fly on Lake Mead. Can't do it anymore. I wanted to have a location on the strip. So I could land a helicopter on the strip where we could have people walking off the street and look to their flights and so forth. Absolutely not. The city told me, wasn't just no, it was hell no. Not a helicopter, right? And then, when I tried really hard to go get my own heliport, I started going down the road to get my own heliport, a private heliport in Las Vegas. And then the city said, it can't happen. I did community impact studies. I held community meetings. I did environmental studies. And I'm in the middle of all this, and they passed a state law. They snuck it into that of a tax bill. They put a moratorium on all heliports in Clark County. You can't have it. Legally, you can't open a heliport. You can't get a use permit to land a heliport in Clark County. I'm thinking, this is unbelievable. How do you do business? And so I sat down with a bunch of my students and I said, I've got to bring you guys up to speed on where we're at. You know, a lot of the work we're going to do is going to have to be outside of Las Vegas because I can't land in the canyon. And I want this place on the strip and they shut me down. And I want to go to California. They won't let me have it. And now they passed a new law that says the county must build a heliport 35 miles away towards California. And all helicopter operators that are doing business on county property have to move to that county, up to that new heliport, 35 miles in the wrong direction. And this is just impossible. That eliminates strip tours. You can't do strip tours anymore. You can't do flights around to Las Vegas, so they're important. But when I was talking to my students, one of the guys says, well, you know, you should have told me that. It's my aunt, Mr. Chairman of the Board of the County Commissioners. Another guy says, yeah, no, my brother wants a state senator. parts of the community, well, politically also to make the developers and so forth, that said, we want to help you. Today, we have the only private airport, heliport in Clark County. The chairman of the Board of County Commission said, hey, I know where there's one. Back in 1981, this guy came in and asked for a use permit. We know anything about it, so we sent him to the FAA, you know, just get that, an airport license. She goes, I don't think he uses that, let me introduce you to him. She introduced me to my father. Then the only other place you could do operations out of was Boulder City, Nevada. It's the only other airport not owned by the county. So I ran out there and bought that too. Right? I bought the terminal building out there and controlled the ramp and the fuel out there. And I got the right place on the strip. And I got permission to land in the bottom of the Grand Canyon. And we started operations in the bottom of Grand Canyon. But we did all of those things because the people who were my students and now becoming my employees knew the area. They knew the people. They can get things done I can't. That I couldn't ever. See, people will do more for you than they will because of you, right? And do you folks all from New York? For most of you? So a lot of you guys live pretty close around here. How many of you have lived here for more than, say, 15 years? There you go. And some of you maybe even all your lives. Now think about this. If you wanted to do something in this town, would you know who to call? Would you know what direction to go? Would you know what to expect from the counties and the cities and so forth? You would. You're from here. You certainly know that, well, the only thing I'm doing is I'm going to get this guy to help you out. If some company comes in from Las Vegas, that's not going to happen. We can't walk into this city, into this county, or into this state, and just expect that we're entitled to something. We're not. You are. You're from here. So what we learned is we hire people who are local. We bring those people in, we train them for the workforce. We're a local company. We're a grassroots company overnight. It works. As a matter of fact, it works so well that when I was going through my building the business in 2002 still, it was June of 2002. We just got our first flight school going. We were going for a few months. We got a phone call. There was a missing girl named Elizabeth Smart. You guys remember that? The Elizabeth Smart girl missing in Utah. We got a phone call when we went to Utah to look for this little girl that was missing. We were up there for 5 days. During the time that we were up there, I got a picture up here. During the time we were up there, we flew every square inch of Utah, I believe, and then some. And I said, boy, this would be a great place to have a business. You know, if we had a helicopter company up here, those airplanes are wow. They think we are, but they're but I thought if we had a helicopter business in Utah, we could do heli-skiing, we could do tours and charters, we could do, there's a lot of, that's really how it works, everybody. There's a lot of lift work activity, construction work that they do up there. There's surveying work, there's firefighting and contracts. And I was looking at all this business and I was thinking, this would be a great place, and it's close enough to Las Vegas. I could operate in Salt Lake City. And I had several people tell me, listen, I really appreciate that you're here and you're helping out with the search for Elizabeth Smart, but you're not from here. Don't do business here, because it won't work for you. If you're not, if you're really here from Salt Lake City, you guys know what I'm talking about. If you're not from there, it's a very tight niche community. Forget it. But when we started having the success we did in Las Vegas, I thought, well, geez, what if we went to Salt Lake City? Instead of opening the business there and renting people, what if we did the same thing? We just hire local people. Today, I have two locations in Utah. Provo, Utah, a 14-acre facility. We have 58,000 square feet of office and warehouse space here in Provo. We got our own paint shop, the rebuild center, we rebuild helicopters there. We have literally between our employees and the students who are building our training programs, there are hundreds of people in Utah right now, here and also in Ogden, Utah. That's the old building in Ogden, we've got a brand new location up there too. We are the contractor for the heli-ski operations in Utah. So if you go into Utah and you want to heli-ski, you're riding on our helicopters. So the same thing, because we've got the Utah operation, they're sister to the companies in Idaho. Of course, we opened up in Idaho. At the Idaho contracts as well. One of our heli-ski operations that you see here, these guys are, they fly these guys into the mountains where there's no ski routes. It's a really neat deal. But the point is this. The reason we're in Utah, the reason we're successful in Utah, all the people there are from Utah. I have one employee, one person, that works out of our Utah location that's not from Utah, because I sent him up there to start the office. He ended up marrying a girl up there, and he's still there. Everybody else is locals. There's nothing we can't do. we got this business going, we've been going for a little while. I got a phone call one day from the governor of Montana, named Judy Martz. And she said, "Hi, this is Judy Martz, I'm the governor of Montana, and I want to know what it would take to get you to bring your company to Montana." And I said, "Well, a phone call from the governor is a good start. But here's the thing, we can't just go there and open a business unless there's something to do. What do you got?" And she says, "Well, I don't know, I'm not really sure. I know we have firefighting contracts." I said, "We'll take those. What else you got?" And we finally went up there and we sat down and we met with them and we said, "We can only train people if we can keep them busy when we're done training them. And what we needed was help from the state. I don't want help. They offered to give us, 30 acres of land if we go through, but I don't want land. I want jobs." What I wanted and what we got was an agreement with that state government that if there's a contract offered by the state, if there's a federal contract, if there's local contracts with private companies, the state will always step up and request or write the bid request in such a way to give us preferential treatment. Why? Not because we're coming from Las Vegas, because we're coming from Montana. See, when we do business there, the money stays there. People buy nicer houses, people drive nicer cars, and they stay in the community. That's a great thing. And that was what, when I thanked the chairman of the county commission in Las Vegas, I said, "I really appreciate all the help you guys give us. You rolled up the red carpet." She goes, "Are you kidding me? A company like this, that hires local people, trains local people, keeps them employed with good pay? This is like a dream to have that. And it's a job where people love what they do." And I'm going to talk to you about that. Being a helicopter pilot is not something you do. It's something you are. It really is something you become. And a lot like law enforcement. People that you may know, or some of you may be in that profession that are firefighters or law enforcement police officers, you don't just take your hat off at the end of the day, go home and not be one anymore. It consumes your life. This job is something that truly changes your life and something you become. And getting a new mouthpiece and things. When you start your training program, when you first get started, you literally, there's so much to learn and it's so intriguing that you'll drive down the road making helicopter noises with your lips. When you watch the weather, it's different. Right now, I used to watch the weather and I wait for the little picture to come up to show you if the sun's going to shine or not. And now we watch the weather and we're looking for the isobars, the high and low pressure systems. We're looking because we want to know how that's going to affect the way we work the next day. It completely changes your life. And then I want to talk about some of the things that we do. There's a list here that we've gotten involved with. Law enforcement, I'll start with. When we first started this business, as I told you a minute ago, that's all we were interested in doing is being a law enforcement contractor. Providing police helicopters for small police departments and sheriff's office that otherwise couldn't afford it. Today, we provide helicopters for 28 sheriff's offices in the United States and police departments and one country. There's a country called the Turks and Caicos Islands, 575 miles south of Florida, that we provide a helicopter for as well. These helicopters, if you'll notice the helicopters, some of the photos you're seeing right here, this is a sheriff's helicopter that's owned, operated, and controlled by us. Now, it's got the sheriff's department's badge on the side, their name on the side, and typically the person sitting in the seat that controls the spotlight and the forward-looking infrared systems, the cameras, the radios, is a deputy sheriff, one of the observers that's from them. But the pilot is one of our guys. This R-43, we operate turbine aircraft. We have Gulf 407s and MD-500s and Hueys and all of that good stuff. But we use this as our primary platform, the R-44 helicopter. We call it the Crown Victoria of helicopters because it really is something that stays in the air for 3.5 hours at a time. It's got the best safety record in the history of helicopters. It'll do 150 miles an hour anytime you need to do it. You can haul passengers. It's got a hook on it. And it's got all the equipment on it. 20 million counterpart spotlight and flare systems. We operate night vision goggles. Everything. And we can operate for a sheriff's office, for a police department, for typically about one-third of what it would cost them to operate their own helicopter. We can amortize costs if they can't. Right? Our insurance costs on our helicopters are amortized over many more hours than theirs are. We fly more than the U.S. Army does. We fly better than 15,000 hours a month with our fleet. That's a pretty impressive number. But because of that, we've got buying power on our insurance, on our rebuilds, on our equipment, on our parts, on our maintenance that helps us keep costs down that other companies and certainly smaller parts couldn't afford. Part of our law enforcement also is the search and rescue, which we'll talk about in a minute. Homeland Security. Our Homeland Security, we have helicopters that are set up now actively working for border patrol operations. I'm not sure which contracts that are shown here. And we do disaster reliefs. Hurricane Katrina, if you guys remember Hurricane Katrina, obviously you can't even remember that, but if you remember the helicopters that showed up Hurricane Katrina. I can't see the screen because of this plant right here, so I'm going to change that. There we go. But the helicopters that showed up in Hurricane Katrina, those were our helicopters. We were the first ones there. We brought in Huey, Police R-44, and then we had a couple of jet rangers that were assigned to us there when we got there. We delivered food and water and medical supplies. And then at night, we go out and do law enforcement activities. Here's some of the photographs of the supplies. The Huey that you see in this picture, we took the 1969 military Huey and completely rebuilt it. Bigger engines, bigger transmission, different blades, different tail rotor, different strength kit, or what they call it, different tail. So we literally were lifting twice as much as the military helicopter military Hueys were lifting them around there. This is a picture of a family that we had delivered insulin to. And you know, something as simple as that, but during Hurricane Katrina, there was no power, there was no fuel, there was no way for people to get medical supplies and get equipment. And so even something as simple as insulin was impossible to get, but the helicopters were a big part of it. This is the FBO. We flew down to Gulfport, Mississippi. We just took over a building down there, and the state of Mississippi swore us with their state patrol and gave us the authority to just do whatever was needed to be done. And it was a great, great experience. And I'll tell you, my hat's off to the people of Mississippi, because there's a lot of very, very good people there that were working very hard and to help us. We're very appreciative of the things that we did. Tours, aerial tours. Another thing that we're involved in, and you'll see that here. There's a few things in New York to go take a look at. There's this big statue. They got a river, and it really is a beautiful place for tourists to come and be able to see things. And even local people would love to see things, family members and so forth. Our helicopters, we are certified under every level that you can be with the FAA. We have a 135 certificate, our air charter, our taxi license. We have our air ambulance license. We've got our agriculture license and so forth. But for taking passengers, we're licensed to pick people up and take them to a particular spot. Now, earlier, the Tuttles came up and welcomed us, which I appreciate, to your community. We got involved with the Tuttles for not aerial tours, but charter work. They were looking for a helicopter so they could get in and out of New York and in and out of some of these other areas and fairly quickly. They had met a gentleman named Ned Beatty. I don't know if you guys remember Ned Beatty from, I'm not supposed to say Deliverance because that's not his favorite movie, but Superman. He's been in a whole bunch of movies. And Ned was working here on Broadway and had met the Tuttles. And I was talking to them and mentioned that his son, Wally, worked for us and struck up a conversation with Wally. They started talking about their need for a helicopter. We said, gee, we'd love to have a motorcycle built for us. And we were looking for something to do as a charitable donation. We thought, what a great win if we had Orange County Choppers build us a motorcycle, and we could take that motorcycle and we'll tour it, and then we'll auction it off, and we give the money to St. Joseph's Hospital. The reason we chose St. Joseph's Hospital, which is in Arizona, is because in August of last year, my daughter was born with a 0% chance of survival in Las Vegas, a 10% chance of survival if we could get her to Arizona in time, which would better fly her down there. And today, she is a healthy, normal little girl, and I have to give that credit to St. Joseph's Hospital. And so... to be able to bring something back to that, it, you know, makes us feel good, but you also look at all the things in between, all the professional people, from the ICU units that they had, the intensive care units, pediatric units in Las Vegas, to the air crew, and I mean, just some unbelievable professionals that took her down and transported her to Arizona, and then this crew of wonderful people down here at this hospital. What a neat thing, and it's a neat thing to be a part of that industry, and I'll talk to you about our involvement in that industry here in just a minute, too. Something that makes me do motion pictures. We got involved in motion pictures some time ago. Remember when they used to have a TV show called Fear Factor on television? We started flying for a Fear Factor TV show some time ago. Now here's the problem with motion pictures. If you want to go out and do something like the Fear Factor thing, you have to storyboard what you're going to do. What that means is kind of like making a cartoon of what you want to do. So you say, okay, they want you to come in and pick these people up off of a boat, they climb up the helicopter, you swing them over the water, come over, they have to take the flags off the ladder or whatever it happens to be. So you have to spell all that out and draw pictures. There's a picture of us. Well, hold that picture if you would, please, Dave, because I want to talk that last one. The one with the, that was one of the recent movies called Red Line, but the next one I want to tell you about because that was kind of funny, so hold that one. But anyway, when you have to go through a lot of trouble to make a motion picture. So we approached the FAA and we said, this is ridiculous. Every time we're going to do a movie, we spend more time, you know, prepping to show you what we're going to do. What they did, finally, was they allowed us to submit a motion picture film waiver, which was approved by the FAA in 2003. What that says is we can go out and do movies without storyboarding. The FAA is convinced that we have the experience and the equipment, and we have the right safety procedures in place, that we are allowed to go outside of the federal guidelines for the purpose of making a movie. So if you see movies where the helicopter, you know, flies into a garage or underneath of a bridge or does something, thank you, does something along that line, that's how we get these things done. So I'm going to tell you this story. I showed up down in Southern California to Oxnard, Coronado area, and I landed alongside the highway. This is the Coast Highway. And one of the guys that was there, who's actually here tonight, that was one of the guys that was working on that set, we said, can you guys come down? We're going to film the Mexican version of Fear Factor. It's called Go for the Green. The reason they call it Go for the Green is if you win, you get a green card. They don't actually hand you a green card, but they hire an attorney for you, you know, and help you get your green card. So now think about this for a minute. Every contestant needs a green card. So you get down there and they pull these people off the street. And instead of having the storyboards and all this, when we got down there, what they did was they said, all right, thank you. They said, is that obvious? What they said was, we got to, now that you're here, we don't know exactly what to do with these people, but they had a boat. And they said, could you lift the boat up? Because there's a big cliff right there. Could you lift the boat up and put it in the water with the helicopter? So we did. We took the boat and we set it in the water. Now they said, well, we made up this ladder. Can you hook the ladder to the bottom of the helicopter and we'll go over to where the boat is and these people have to climb up the ladder and pull the little flags off. And if they can do it within 30 seconds, then you take them over and drop them off on the beach. But if they don't, you punch them off. Now punch them off means there's a little trigger inside the helicopter that releases the hook on the bottom of the helicopter, which means the ladder would literally just fall in the ocean. And this was December, right? So it's very cold down there. So we get down there, I got the guy with me with a cameraman and doing the spotting. The first guy, we go in and we pick him up off the boat, and he climbs up and he gets all the flags in less than 30 seconds, which means he's supposed to take him to the beach. And so, you know, the producer calls us on the radio and he said, punch him off over the ocean. So you don't have to tell me twice, right? I punched him off. He cheated. He tore all the flags instead of unclipping them. So the next time they made him do it again, this poor bugger's out there on the front of this boat freezing his ass off because it's cold out there and it's wet. And this time they said, whatever you do, don't let him get the flags. So we don't have video of that. What we do, but we're not allowed to show it. You know, finish because it's sadistic. But this guy would literally we'd keep him up here, and he'd be hanging on the ladder, and we'd see him, and then he'd disappear, and then we'd call him here, and we'd see him. But anyway, nobody got the flags after that, so it worked out pretty good. Motion picture films are a real kick in the butt. We really enjoy doing them. It's something we do across the country. We have the waivers on many of our helicopters now and our pilots, which allows us to do this. We are SAG carded, Screen Actors Guild carded, and we have the ability to card our employees through the Screen Actors Guild as well. Another thing that we do is motion picture firefighting. Let me tell you about this part of our company. If you want to be involved in firefighting, you've got to be good at it already. Nobody's good at it when they start. So what we did was we went to a company called Ericsson Aircrane. Ericsson Aircrane's been doing this for years. They got the big helicopters that look like a big wasp. Their chief pilot had been running that company for 25 years. His name is Paul Mavernack. We hired Paul from them to come to work for us full time and start and run our firefighting program. So today we contract with Bechtel, Northrop, the Nevada test site, now the state of Oregon. We contract with these outside agencies to provide helicopters for firefighting. But what we did was took it to the next level. If you notice our helicopters, instead of having a bucket that hangs under the helicopter, you see that tank on the bottom of the helicopter? That tank is a storage tank for water. That thing hanging down is a snorkel. So you go down and you dip that in the water that fills the tank up. Now, I want you to watch this real quick because this is kind of funny. This pond, these guys were going to practice this day in Boulder City, and the fire department was supposed to fill up a swimming pool for them and let them fill up the tank. Well, when they got there, the fire department was busy, so they said, well, we found a pond. So they went over to the pond, and they would fill up the tank, as they're doing right now. It takes about 30 seconds for the tank to fill up with this pump system. And then once they get into flight, they can mix the flame retardant with the water, and then they come back and they can release that. Now we can release it very fast or very slow or so forth. I want you to notice when they release this, notice it kind of looks like poo. Okay, that was a sewage pond. Swear to God. And they didn't know it. Now here's the funniest part. Of all the days they did this, that day they invited the film crew to come out. There's film. So the film crew was standing there when you just see that step release. And they're downwind. And they're watching this other guy from Walmart, he comes by and they go, that tastes like shit. And they go, what? But anyway, so we made them keep that thing. They still deny it, but we confirmed it. That's poo. That's Boulder City poo. Anyway, then the firefighting end, with that tank that you just see, we can fight fires. Instead of, if you use those big buckets, you go get the water. Now once you pick up the water, you can't go over 40 knots, which is about 50 miles an hour, because the bucket comes back so far, you get tangled into the tail rotor. You can't fly over houses or people once the bucket's full of water. Because if something goes wrong, you got to release the bucket. Well, hell, you got a bucket weighs a whole bunch coming down. But with the tank that you see, we can go fill up the tank. We can still do 120 knots, which is 130 plus miles an hour, to get out to the scene. We can fly over the top of people and houses. If something goes wrong and we need to release the load, all this is rains on them. Hopefully it's no poop. It's much more efficient than the old way. We can deliver water as much as 10 times faster with this setup, and it's better for the pilots, safer, so it's a really good program. We've covered firefighting. Flight training. The flight training or flight academy part of our company was a necessary evil. And I explained that to you a little while ago and said, when we first started this, we got into flight training simply because we needed pilots. And let me tell you, the absolute honest truth, we sucked at this. We were terrible. It was taking us like more than 2 years to train somebody to fly. And if you went to one of our flight schools, like in Sacramento, California, and then you went to one in Arizona, and you went to one in Las Vegas, you get three different opinions on what to do. It's frustrating. And the helicopters, when we first started flying, we hired these flight instructors that had learned to fly in San Diego and out in Florida and up in Washington, these places. Well, that's what the flight schools are. They were training foreign students before that. So we hired these guys. They come to Vegas. We have four of these little training helicopters, right? Well, remember I told you we were doing the search for Elizabeth Smart? And that was in June. Well, that happened to be the first week that Las Vegas got up into well over 100 degrees, got like 105 degrees. These helicopters don't like to fly in thin air or hot air like that. They fly completely different. So what happened is, I'm up doing this Elizabeth Smart thing, and I'll never forget it. I'm standing in front. I've got all these news cameras out there with our helicopters. My phone rings, and I answer it. It's one of the flight instructors. And he says, "Hey, Jerry, we just wrecked one of the Robinson helicopters." I go, "Well, that sucks. Everybody's okay?" "Yeah." And I go, "Well," and they said, "all the things you're supposed to say, well, as long as everybody's okay." But I'm really thinking, of course, is those are $200,000. But I said, "How'd it happen?" He goes, "Well, we did the same thing we always do. You have to be able to land the helicopter without the engine. Right? You got to be able to shut the engine off and auto-rotate. It's part of your training." And we train it all the time, every day. It's a no big deal. But he said, "We were practicing it. We shut the engine off. We came down. And when we went to flare, which slows the helicopter down, it just wouldn't slow down. It hit the ground, split the skids, and rolled over on the side. So there's nothing left of it. You know, it's going to need a dust pan and it's heated up." And so I said, "Well, okay, we'll deal with it when I get back." So the next day I got a phone call from a different flight instructor. He says, "Did you hear about the helicopter?" I said, "I did." And he said, "Nobody got hurt. That's what's important." I said, "I agree. I already said that." And he said, "It's just hard to believe that we wrecked two in a row." I go, "Two? Well, the one yesterday and the one today." I go, "That sucks." Here's the rest of the story. No, the later mistake. By the time I got back, we're gone for a week, 5 days. They wrecked them all. Four helicopters. Nothing left of any of them. But, well, they're in pieces. They wrecked them all. And when I came back, there are about 35 or 36 people that work for the FISDO office. The FISDO is the Flight Standard District Office. It's the division of the FAA, the federal government, that is their enforcement division. I know that there's about 35 or 36 people work there because that's how many were in my office when I got back. Seriously, they had this big meeting, and I show up and they go, "What the hell are you doing? You guys wrecked four helicopters in a week. You guys shouldn't be flying helicopters anymore." I go, "Well, that's a little broad. We shouldn't be maybe training. But we never had an issue, an incident. We just got through flying around Utah, 12,000 feet, for a week, and low and slow, and doing some of the most dangerous stuff you can do. We didn't wreck anything." But here's what happened. We took flight instructors that had learned how to fly helicopters at sea level, and we brought them to an area where at 105 degrees, that helicopter doesn't want to fly anymore, and your energy management skills better be amazing. And you better fly completely different. But they didn't. They did exactly the same thing they'd always done. It snows here, doesn't it? Okay, when it snows here, do you drive a little different than you do when it's not snowing? Do you ever notice people that come here from out of town drive the same way when it snows, and there you end up in a ditch, right? Doesn't make them, you've done that? They don't know how to drive in snow. And that's just, now that doesn't make them a bad driver. It just means they don't know how to drive in snow. Right? Black ice. You guys see black ice here? Right? You know that if it's been wet and it's cold and you can see stars, you got black ice. And by God, if you come up to a bridge, it's going to be accelerated, right? But you get some guy that's been driving somewhere all his life that doesn't know what black ice is, bring him back from Florida, wherever it is, and the first time he gets here, he can't keep a car on the road. That's what we did to these pilots. We took pilots that have been trained in places like Florida and Southern California and Oregon, and we stuck them in Las Vegas, where it's 2,300 feet above sea level. Then it's 105 degrees, so it's 8,000 feet above sea level as far as the helicopter goes. And we said, "Go turn the engine off and land it." And the helicopter goes, "I don't think so." So when we started realizing that, we didn't figure this out on our own. We brought in the absolute best of the best, because we had an obligation. And that is, I promised these students we're going to put these people to work. I was trying to build a company. I didn't have any other options. I can't go out and find pilots. I can train pilots. That's my option. And so we had to do it right. Now, I'll tell you, here's what we've done. This is a company that wrecked four helicopters in a week. This is a company that, there is some good news here. There's good side to everything, right? When I got back from Utah, the insurance company said, "You know, we're going to cancel your insurance because you wrecked that helicopter on Monday." I said, "You have no idea. You should have canceled on Monday because I got three more you're going to pay me for." And I've been paying them back ever since. I guess that was the win. Anyway, where we are today. today, the same company that literally, you know, safety-wise, we were lacking today. We've got our incident rate is 4 to 6 times better than the rest of the helicopter industry combined. That's not my opinion. That's AIG Insurance, AirAsure Insurance, what they gave us our stats at the end of last year in writing. The Helicopter Association International, which is our the industry that we all that leads us, put us on their international safety team. We're the only company on the international safety team that's not a manufacturer. Every other company that represents them is a manufacturer. The FAA developed the FAST, I didn't know we had it. The FAST team is a Federal Aviation Safety Team. There were 9 companies in the United States invited to be members of the FAST team to develop new safety flight procedures for everyone who operates aviation. That means the same procedures that we help develop apply to JetBlue, Southwest, and Continental, and to every helicopter operator. We, the company that used to suck at this, and now we're the industry leader in safe operations of helicopters. That's something to be really proud of. And it's because we brought in the best of the best. We made changes. And when you look at the other part of our flight academy, all that stuff that I can tell you about, you've got to be able to read somebody's writing. Now we have a training program. We use a distance learning training program that we developed. It is state-of-the-art. The Chancellor of University of Las Vegas told us that our distance learning training program is years ahead of anything they have. What that means is, where you used to have to come into a classroom 3 or 4 nights a week, today, you can log on to the internet, here's an example of it, and you can take your training courses on the internet. You've got the talking figure up on the left, you've got everything, you've got CAD systems, you can review work, you can take your tests, everything, it's fully animated, it's an amazing system. And you do your training online, and your testing online. That's kind of neat, I've never seen this before, so it's kind of cool. They just told me that they had that added to one of the slide presentations to show you how distance learning works. But it also means that if you're in Arizona, or you're in New York, or you're in Oakland, you get the same training program from Silver State Helicopters no matter where you're at. And we are a 141 helicopter flight school. And we 141 means that we've got them certified by the FAA under Part 141, so that we can issue visas, we can allow people who have military backgrounds and have qualifications for qualified for loans now to train under the 141 program. We have not rolled out our 141 program to every office yet. And if you need to be in that specific program here, we need to know that so that we can, if there's enough call for it, we can have a 141 operation where it's a little more involved in the training process of the 141. What you got up there, search and rescue. Our search and rescue part of our company is tied to our law enforcement side. It's part of our Sheriff's Airborne Law Enforcement or Specialized Airborne Law Enforcement program. It includes everything from, this is a good example. You see this, on this slide right here, they're showing that's an airplane that crashed. Yeah, that was February 5th of this year. In the Turks and Caicos Islands, which is in the Caribbean, there was a Part 121, which is a scheduled airliner, that crashed. It had 6 people on board at the time, and it crashed in the ocean at night in an area that was unlit. And I mean, when I say it was dark, it was ink bottle dark. We responded to that crash site. We recovered 6 people from that crash site. 5 of the 6 people are alive today. And it just happened that I happened to be there that day, and I got to fly I flew the mission myself with the topper, a couple of other pilots brought some helicopters. But I tell you what, that's what I signed up for. Right? I didn't get involved in this business to stand up here and talk to people. I didn't get involved in this business to sit behind a desk. I got involved in this business because I love to fly helicopters, and I still do it, and I do it all the time. And it's cool because I get to fly, you know, everything that we own because I own the company. You know, it's kind of cool. Otherwise, it wouldn't happen that way. Anyway, some of the stuff we do. Heavy lift operations. The heavy lift operations is something, but I'll tell you, again, you got to be good at it. And we hire guys that are best of the best, from Carson Aircraft, from Columbia Helicopters, from Ericsson Air Cranes. And so we go out now today and we do everything from lifting air conditioning systems that we set on roofs to, well, this is a seismic contract. We have a contract right now that goes from Washington State all the way to Maine, and they're drilling a million holes. They drill the ground. So we take the workers, we drop them off, they drill the holes, they set the charges. We take those seismic sensors, we place them all over the place. They set up the charge, and then the sensors can tell them, you know, what's in the ground, basically. And then we hopscotch across the country. This is the kind of work that we do that, believe me, if you take one of our tour pilots and one of our longline pilots and this kind of stuff, these are two completely different people, right? The tour pilot gets up in the morning, and he puts on his shiny shoes and black pleated pants. He's got a white shirt, got little gold bars called epaulets here. Got his name, says Captain something on there. And every morning he goes out to his helicopter, and he's got an air-conditioned Bell 407 or a Long Ranger helicopter, and he puts people on, and he flies them someplace, and waits for them, puts them back, and takes them back, and it's dark, and he's home. You take one of those guys that flies those lift jobs out in the middle of frickin' nowhere, they're living in, we buy them these toy hauler trailers, and so they're living in a toy hauler, they wear a flight suit, which they never wash, and they'll tell you that if they do, then it becomes less fire resistant, which isn't true, they just, they're pigs. They don't shower either, so what's the interpretive excuse then? But these guys are just kind of the rough and rugged guys that love what they do, which is they get into a helicopter that has no air conditioning, no frills, and just them and a mechanic and an aircraft and a fuel truck, and they go out and just do the job for months at a time, and they love doing it. We do everything that has that you can do in a helicopter from every extreme. What else do we not talk about? Search and rescue, heavy lift, air transport. Obviously, air transport is VIP transport, exactly like we're doing here for the Tuttles. We provide a helicopter, we provide a pilot. The helicopter can be private labeled for that specific company or that organization, which means it's theirs for exclusive use. Now, something you should know is the Tuttles helicopter that's sitting out here, the Orange County Chopper helicopters, when they're not using it, it's available to the public. So you can charter that aircraft. You can use it to fly in and out of New York. You can do weddings in it. You can use it to charter a lift for it. Say you're going to do a lift aircraft, a hook on it for lifting air conditionings and so forth. The helicopter can be used just to do a scenic tour. You want to get somebody, you know, take somebody at Christmas time and give a gift to take them out and show them the area. That helicopter is available to the public when they're not using it. Obviously, their schedules only allow them to be able to use a helicopter about 20 to 30 hours a month. So most of the time it's available. It's a good thing for us that we still have the VIP transport we do. We transport the president of the Turks and Caicos Islands. We have the contract to transport him and his cabinet in a Bell 222 or 230, big twin-engine helicopter, looks like airline. Aerial photography is just that. We take people up in helicopters and take pictures of things. And that is usually still photos, anything from local news to newspapers to real estate agents and so forth. What else we got? Agriculture. Agriculture is something that we're very, very big into now. We bought last year a company called Central Washington Helicopters. Central Washington Helicopters obviously is up in Washington State, and we operate helicopters up there that include the Hueys, the Jet Rangers, the Long Rangers, the MD-500s, the R-44s. There's a picture of an R-44 that we outfitted with a spray rig on it. And so there's an MD-500 with a spray rig on it. So these pilots that do agricultural work, this is really interesting because this is one of the first jobs that you will do as a commercial pilot. If you want to do ag work, you can go into ag work with about 500 hours of experience. And so you become a flight instructor, it takes very little time to move into ag work if you go and work in these different areas. Ag work includes everything from spraying pesticides and herbicides, and then during the rainy season, we do drying with the helicopters. We dry the cherry trees. The cherries get water in where the stem meets in the cherry. It'll split the cherry if the sun comes out and shines on it. So we get on and blow that off of there. We dry baseball fields and race tracks with helicopters. And then we also go out on the real cold time of the year. We'll hover over the crops and push the warm air down on the crops so that the frost doesn't get to the crops. Upside down in the middle of the night. That's one of those jobs you don't volunteer for more than once. So the first you go, hey, I'll do that. And then you're going to go, it's freaking 3 in the morning and I'm out here freezing my pants off. It's dark. Anyway, we do other types of agricultural work. Holiday cornfields. You hover over the top of cornfields, because you have male and female, here's corn, and you can pollinate the cornfields that way. Mosquito abatement, that's where we go out and spray areas to kill mosquitoes and waterways and so forth. So it's a big, big business for us. We are the largest agricultural helicopter company in the United States today. And we do it because we enjoy it. It's good for us, it's profitable for us. It's a great way too for our pilots to get transitioned into larger aircraft and move into the different fields that they want to move into before they start taking passengers. There's one other thing that's not on the list right here, and that's air ambulance. I've always wanted to be an air ambulance. I've always wanted to have helicopters for rescue situations, and more than just a helicopter that transport people from hospital to hospital. I want helicopters that show up on the scenes of accidents, that can do extractions and these things. Last year, we bought a company in Arizona that had been in business since 1978, and we went out and started rebuilding these Bell 230s. The Bell 230, again, it looks like the Airwolf helicopter. It's a great Bell twin-engine helicopter, very, very reliable, and it's got plenty of room on the inside of the aircraft. We have four helicopters now in the state of Arizona, and now we've expanded our Bell 230 EMS program. We're expanding it now throughout the rest of the nation. We will eventually have an air ambulance helicopter located right here in New York, this facility. We love that part of the business. I'm going to cover one more thing. You notice all these helicopters I'm showing you that we have in our fleet? If you're familiar with the industry, our helicopters are all Bell helicopters, and ND helicopters, and Robinson helicopters. These helicopters all have something in common. They're all made in the United States, and there's no coincidence there. One of the largest selling helicopters in this nation, and the most commonly used helicopters in this nation, over the past 15 years, is called the Eurocopter. And a lot of you that are familiar with this industry know that the Eurocopter, that's an EC-120 there. That's the only Eurocopter we have. I bought that specifically there's a movie called The Transformers that's coming out. We bought two of those to make the movie. We sold one, and if anybody wants that one, I'll make it over New York. They specifically made that movie. The Eurocopter helicopters have really taken over the helicopter industry, not because they're a better helicopter, but because they're easier to acquire, right? They have easy financing and lease programs and so forth. And because of that, a lot of the helicopter operators have switched to the Eurocopter. The Eurocopter is made in France, so it's a French-made product. Now, here's one of the reasons we don't fly a helicopter. It's made in France. And that's not just because they don't like us and all that, but our helicopters have all been used in war. Right? The Bell helicopters have been used since the Vietnam era, and they've been through millions of flight hours of being shot at, having way too much weight on them, and being in the worst possible situations. And we had lots and lots of mistakes that were made by these companies, but they all were fixed through our military before we ever got our butts in these helicopters. Those French helicopters, the French don't go to war, right? They did have a little white flag that popped up on them, find them all over the desert. They don't have the history behind them. They don't have the track record that the American helicopters do. And because of that, we don't want to be test pilots. We stick with aircraft that are predictable, aircraft that are simple to fly, and aircraft that we can be proud of. And we really are proud that we fly American-made aircraft, and we always will. Try saying that in Texas. There's the Bell Triple Deuce right there. That's one of our executive transport aircrafts. That was the long range right there. So, here's what it takes. If this is something you want to do, hang on a second. If this is something you want to do, here's what it takes to do it. There's a couple of things that will disqualify you. One is, and probably the most misconception, is eyesight. Your eyesight has to be correctable to 20/40. So if you're wearing glasses or contact lenses and that gets you into the 20/40 and better, you're good. This isn't the military, so you're good. However, you cannot be colorblind. You must be able to distinguish the difference between reds and blues. And that's very important. You will have to take a flight physical before you can take your first flight in a helicopter and as the pilot in command. So we have doctors specifically that will inspect you. This site physical does not involve a glove unless you request it. You might. It's a fairly simple site physical, a series of questions, check your eyesight, check your hearing and reflexes and so forth, peripheral vision, make sure you don't have like vertigo and that type of thing. As a matter of fact, if you have vertigo, that can be an eliminator because the blades on the helicopter can induce the vertigo for you. You also cannot be dependent on medication that is an antidepressant medication. Dependent means that you're still taking it. If you have taken antidepressant medications before, it has to be 6 months from the last time you took it till the time you take your flight physical in order for it not to count against you. You don't need antidepressants when you're flying helicopters. We can demonstrate that for you. The other eliminators are going to be if you're epileptic or have seizures, if you are insulin dependent. And I have had people that take insulin and have on a regular basis for years that have been able to get waivers and still be able to get this done. But it's got to be a real good track history that the doctor, medical surgeon feels good about. Some of the other eliminators are going to be, for instance, your personal history. If you've got felony convictions, now I understand a felony is different in every state. If you've ever been convicted of a particularly heinous crime, if you don't know what that is, then you probably haven't, but murder, rape, child molest, those types of things, we cannot train you. We cannot license you to be a helicopter pilot. If you never fly with passengers, we will not bring you into the program if that's the issue. There are some things that can really mess up your application, like a recent drunk driving. If you've been arrested for drunk driving recently within the last couple of years, there's the idea that if you're not smart enough to not get behind the wheel of a car after drinking, then maybe you shouldn't be in a helicopter. Here's something that you have to consider. If the reason that you have not been arrested for drunk driving is because you've never been caught, rather than because you don't do that, this is going to work for you. If you went through this program and completed it, and you spent, the average student now is taking almost 15 months to complete this program. If you did that, completed this program, and then you get arrested for drunk driving, you lose your license. It's gone. All that work for nothing. But we're pretty cool about the whole financing. Now we have this a really good outside financing program. It's exactly the same program that we used to do, only it's through an outside bank, and they're actually more lenient, better rates. And that is, you don't start paying until after you finish the program, 6 months later. But guess what? You get arrested for drunk driving, you lose your license, you still got to pay back for all the training you got, only you got nothing for it. Okay? Drug use. If you've been admitted or arrested for the use of hallucinogens, phencyclidine, PCP, LSD, and these things, in most cases it's an eliminator, even if it was many, many years ago. Marijuana is not an eliminator, but it has to have a lot of history between the times that you used it and the times that you apply. And I say a lot of history, if you gotta look at your watch to tell me the last time you smoked pot, this isn't for you. And it's not something where you go, well, I'll just quit. That's not how it works. Quit, prove it, come back in a couple of years. Don't think that you're going to quit now because of this new goal, this new idea. It's just that it's not something where you take this kind of risk anymore. You must be submitted to random drug testing. And all those little things you hear about on TV, the little tricks on how to pass that test, are bullcrap. They don't work. Right? One of the eliminators that's probably the hardest one for me personally is a person's size, their weight. And when I say it's the hardest one, it's because there's a lot of people out there that are really good people, nice people, friendly people, good work ethic. They've got everything going for them, but they're simply big. These helicopters have a seat weight limit, the R-22 helicopter. You're going to spend most of your first 100 plus hours going to be one of those helicopters. The seat weight limit is 240 pounds, which means legally, we cannot let you ride in that helicopter if you weigh more than 240 pounds. Now, does that mean that if you are 239 pounds naked, that you can now fly that? No. First of all, we don't let you fly naked. I got a phone call more than once. But I really have. You guys are kidding about that. But we're also not going to push the limit on this aircraft. We are at sea level here. Because of that, we've got some room to move. But realistically, 215 or 220 is where you're going to have to be at the top of this deal in order to be able to fly for us to train you. And you're going to spend, like I said, a lot of time in that helicopter. Out of the first 200 hours that you fly with us, 170 of those 200 hours are in our R-22 helicopter, 30 are in our R-44, the bigger helicopter that you see over there. The seat weight limit of an R-44 is 300 pounds. But again, 250, 260, you know, is probably realistic in an aircraft like that. But what you don't want to do is all of a sudden, you know, your weight jumps up the day you get out of the R-22, the R-44. We have had people that were bigger than that have done all of their training in R-44, which allows you to be bigger from the start. That is obviously a more expensive program, and it does limit what you'll do for a living when you get out of the program. You would need to become an instrument-rated flight instructor, instrument instructor, because all of our instrument instruction, we teach people to fly without moving outside, is done in the R-44. So it does allow us to have people who are bigger guys, if those are instrument instructors, still have an occupation where they can build their hours and move themselves into the bigger ships. It is definitely not the optimum situation to be in. The number one eliminator, just who you are, personality, work ethic, attitude. We just want people, this is not something you try. You go, hey, I know something, like, okay, I'll try. This is what this is about. This is something that you just own it. You wear it. You are. You live this thing. You've got to have such a passion about this. Because I'm going to tell you, you will eat, sleep, and breathe helicopters for the next year of your life. Your family members are going to have to be so supportive of you as you go through this program, because you're going to need their help as you go through your study. You're going to spend 15 or 20 hours in a week online and doing your study courses, coming into classes, flying in a helicopter, right? You've got to be able to say that during that first year, especially, it's got to be your priority to get this done, which makes it your family's priority too, doesn't it? To allow that to happen. We even tell, if you have like a relative that dies, freeze them until after the year is over, you know? And let them know ahead of time that you're going to, and then they should go. So if all of that is, and you're the right person and so forth, here's the steps it takes to make this work. The first thing you do is what you did today, which is come here and sweat your butt off and listen to us talk. If you say, this is a company I want to work for, and this is something I want to do, then you fill out an application. If you fill out the application, which you'll be able to do here this afternoon, or you can turn it in later, we have a team of people that will be here for about the next 10 days going through applications, 7 to 10 days. They will take about 50 or 60 people from this group, and you say, well, dude, that's a lot. Well, believe me, there's a lot of people here that either don't qualify or can't qualify, or have to be for one reason or another, weight, drug history, criminal history, and so forth. But they'll take the people that do apply, They'll look through your applications and they'll say, hey, this guy looks good on paper. This guy is, women make great helicopter pilots. But if everything looks good on paper, they're going to invite you in. And when you come in, we want you to bring your spouse with you, your husband or wife with you. And we're going to sit down with you and talk about what it really takes, the level of commitment, make sure it's something that you absolutely can do and will do. We want you to bring your spouse because there's a commitment on their side too, to get this done. Like I said, you're going to go to bed reading helicopter books. You know, you're sitting on the crapper reading helicopter books. You're online all the time. It's just consuming for you. And we need that support. If during the interview you decide and we decide this is the right thing for you, then we're going to take you out and put you in a helicopter, and we're going to do a demonstration flight for you, where we'll give you just 10 or 15 minutes of what it's really like to be a helicopter pilot. And you bring your spouse with you too. We do that because we want to make sure when you step out of the helicopter, you're dancing the jig, right? That it really is something that you go, this is me. This is what I'm going to spend my life doing. Helicopter pilots don't stop being helicopter pilots. It's a very interesting thing. If you look at the number of people who are licensed in a particular profession that actually work in that profession, it's a very small percentage. Look at the number of commercial helicopter pilots in the United States that fly helicopters for a living. It's better than 99%. Right? That's incredible. This is not something that you get a certificate and you don't do. It becomes what you'll do for the rest of your life. And you'll love it, and it's a great job. It's something that you'll never conquer. You'll never, you know, a lot of people say, well, you know, what is it about the flight of helicopter that keeps you so passionate? And have you guys all played video games before? You notice when you play a video game, if you conquer the video game, you don't want to play it anymore. Right? You'll never conquer this. You never will. I don't care how long you've been flying. I've been flying since 1996. I still get out there every once in a while and I go, holy gee whiz, and get the little belly pressed and thing going in my legs, scare the shit out of myself. That's still going to happen to you. I'm always learning something new. Everybody, I got guys flying for me. Paul Adernack, when he came to work for me, had been flying for 25 years. Right? He had 14,000 hours on with a load underneath the helicopter. And when he came in and interviewed with me, he goes, hey, the one thing is, I'd love to go to work for your company as long as I'm still flying a helicopter. I'll put me behind a desk. Right? You never conquer this thing. And there's so much going on at the same time, and there's so many variables. This is nothing. How many of you fly airplanes? Okay? They have almost nothing in common, other than we share airspace. Almost nothing in common. And so when you get into helicopters, I flew airplanes also, and got into airplanes after I got into helicopters, but I never got that. I never got that challenge. You know, airplanes, once in a great while, you go, hey, gee whiz, that was kind of scary. Well, the helicopter, it's all the time. I mean, both of your feet, your left arm, your left wrist, your right hand, your right thumb, all working together at the same time. If you pull up on this, you gotta push down on the left pedal. What you do, the helicopter goes into flight. It wants to go that way, translating tendency. So the cycle's gotta come back this way. It is constant. If you wanna get an idea of all of that movement together, when you get home today, get like a basketball or a bowling ball and set a board on it, like a 4-foot by 4-foot board, and you stand on the board and just try to balance yourself while you're juggling live cats. That's the danger of that part. It really is. It's just there's so much going on. So when we start you off, and that's what I'm leading to. You've gone through, you fill out the application, you go through the demonstration flight, everything's great. Then we're going to have you come into an orientation. On the second day of July, we're going to have an orientation back at our office here for every person that's in this class. So you come to orientation, you bring your family members to that too. The orientation is about, we show you our cards. We show you a lot more about this company than we'd ever do standing on the stage in front of an awful lot of people. And where we are, where we've been, and where we're going, and where an open book. And then the next week, next Monday after that, is when it officially starts the first week of classes. But you will be given, once you've been accepted in the program, your online identification. You'll be able to go online and start your training. You also are going to start scheduling yourself to come in and fly in the flight simulator. Back in that trailer you see back there, I encourage you to look at it after the seminar, that is a flight simulator that was built, designed by us and built by Frasca. So here's some pictures of it. Simulator is as close to a helicopter as you can get in that you have to start it just like you would a helicopter, monitor the same gauges, all the same inputs. You're going to spend somewhere between 7 to 10 hours in this simulator getting all these things done before we put you in a helicopter. You're going to wreck that simulator a whole bunch of times. It's got a little button you push, reset button, and you're back where you started. These don't have reset buttons in these helicopters. So we put you in the simulator, we get your motor skills down, and we move you to a helicopter. The whole time that you're going through this class, you're taking online courses, you need to commit to come to class at least one night a week. And the classes are in the evenings. Typically, they have one class from 6 to 8, and another one from 8:30 to 10:30. You have to come to at least one class a week, and you take the information that you've already done online. And when you come into the class, it's to make sure that you're where you need to be. You can come every night that we have a class. You can come to all the classes. That simulator, you're required to have 7 to 10 hours in the simulator with an instructor. You can fly 1,000 hours in the simulator if you want to. We don't care. We encourage it. We'll show you how to start it. We'll show you how to set it down. We'll show you how to lock it up when you're done. And we encourage you to fly that simulator all you want, because it can only help you to become a better pilot. But the first 7 to 10 hours are with an instructor. After that, you're welcome to have access to it. Pretty much plug in anyway. What's the difference? We'd love to get you that time. As you're going through this training program, when you get to about 20 to 30 hours of flight time, So you've got the simulator tech behind you, they're going to start putting you into a helicopter at least once a week while you're going through your ground school. And then pretty soon they're going to put you in a helicopter twice a week and then three times a week. Every time they book you in a helicopter, it's going to be for 2 hours at a time. And so your two hours are all going to be different, right? Some of you can come in on Sunday mornings, Saturday evenings, and Wednesday afternoons. And other people will say, listen, I work in the afternoon, I come in during the morning times. But they're going to assign you to a flight instructor. He's going to say, here's what's available, and you guys are going to work it out. And you may have to give some, and we may have to give some, but when we're done, we'll end up with a schedule, and then you'll stick to that schedule, and you'll show up and do your flight times. By the time you get to that 25, 30 hours, the same guy that used to sit next to you in a helicopter that you thought was a god, you will. When you first find this guy, you'll think, he saved my life. Over and over and over again. And he will. Just to the point where you think, we're going to die. And he goes, oh, it's back. I tried it again. It's back. But by the time you get to about 30 hours, you're just like, I wish this guy would get out of this helicopter and let me fly it. And that's what he'll do. And then you go, hey, I'm not really sure I was ready for that. And now you're flying by yourself. And you'll go out and fly all by yourself for about 10 hours. Once you've done that, you are ready to be a private pilot. So you'll take the written test, and then we'll put you with a Czech airman, or you go to the FAA and have them do it, and you'll take the test with them, the flight test, and you are now a private helicopter pilot in an R-22 helicopter. Now here's what's neat. Helicopters aren't like airplanes. You don't have to go get rated for everything you fly. If you get rated in that R-22 helicopter, you can fly any helicopter in the world as long as it weighs less than 12,500 pounds. The only thing that weighs more than 12,500 are like Black Hawks and Chinooks. There's one exception. That helicopter, the R-44, requires 10 hours of dual instruction once you've been licensed in a helicopter. 10 hours of dual instruction. So when you become a private pilot, what we're going to do is put you back with an instructor in one of those. And we're going to get you to 10 hours so that you can now fly literally any helicopter in the world weighs less than 12,500. Now here's part of the reason that we want you in the helicopter qualified. Now that you're a private pilot, you need to get 150 hours of flight time. And this is the fun part, it really is. You talk to some of our students here who are now flight instructors, and they'll tell you, once you hit private pilot, it becomes a real kick in the butt, because you gotta fly a lot. And you're flying by yourself a lot. And we want you to go places and do things and build your experience and get time. But we're also gonna say that we're gonna take 40 hours total of that time, and we're going to teach you to fly instruments. Because you've been flying outside the helicopter all this time, now we're going to teach you to fly off your instruments. So some of the days that you come in, you're going to come in three times a week. And if you come in on a Saturday morning, and again on a Sunday morning, your instructor might say, listen, when you come in on a Sunday, instead of flying in the R-22, I want you in that helicopter with me, and we're going to do instrument training. And then you'll take your online courses, and you'll come into the classes for instrument training, and you will become an instrument-rated helicopter pilot. Every person that goes through our program is instrument rated. It will save your life someday. Well, you live in an area where storm systems form very rapidly. This will save your life someday. Because if you get yourself in a situation, which you will if you fly long enough, where everything looked pretty cool and all of a sudden you can't see anything, you've got to have the ability to go to those gauges and get yourself out of it, and you will. Once you become an instrument rated pilot, you're going to continue to build your time until you get to 150 hours. At 150 hours, you're going to take your test, and you will have taken all the online training as well to become a commercial helicopter pilot. It's actually one of the easier tests to take. But once you become a commercial helicopter pilot, you can now be paid to fly a helicopter. It's pretty cool. But we're not done with you yet. We're going to take the next 25 hours, and we're going to put you back into a course, a training course, spend some time with a flight instructor on the ground and in the air, because we are going to take you to the next level, which is you're going to become a certified flight instructor. You're going to be certified so that you can teach other people how to fly helicopters. By the time you get to 175 hours, you should be done with this course. At 175 hours, you will be instrument rated, passed your private certificate, passed your commercial certificate, and a certified flight instructor. Which sometime during that time, we also will put a hook on a helicopter and a line on a helicopter and put a weight under there and have you pick it up and try to move it around and set it down in the same spot. We don't do this because we're trying to teach you to be a firefighter. We do it because we're teaching you vertical reference. We're teaching you to fly outside the aircraft as well. We're the only academy in the world that trains pilots from scratch to fly outside the aircraft this way, inside the aircraft by instruments, and vertical reference from day one. And I'll tell you, it'll make you an awesome pilot. I used to tell people that this was an inherently dangerous job. That's not true. This is a non-forgiving job. You've got to be a professional. We have the ability to teach you to that level, and we will. And the responsibility to teach you to that level, to be an absolute professional in this helicopter, for your safety, for ours, for the good of this business. Now, I said that you're done at 175 hours. You are. But we will not hire you until you have 200 hours. So the next 25 hours is fun. Take your family and give them rides in a helicopter. Take your spouse and go someplace. You can book a helicopter and go fly someplace. We're happy that you're at that point. You're done. We need 200 hours of experience, and we want you to go out and fly without an instructor, without having to learn anything, and enjoy this flight. And there's a lot of good things happening here. And I've got some criticism. People say, you're really going to put them with their spouse and let them just take a helicopter? I go, well, you were going to put them with a student who's trying to kill them, right? At least the spouse didn't have controls. You could, you're a flight instructor. You can even do that. But we want you to go out and really enjoy this and get your confidence up. And then at 200 hours is when you're eligible to be hired. Now, have we hired everybody that's ever graduated this program? If you did your research, you know there's two people that did not get hired. Two. Both of them because they did something absolutely stupid in the final hour. One guy took a helicopter out unauthorized and wrecked it. Tried to land at 11,000 feet with one of his buddies, and he wrecked the helicopter. They didn't get hurt, wrecked the helicopter. Another guy took the helicopter out unauthorized, and was doing some pretty stupid stuff, you know, running the scud running the earth, and got caught doing it. Those things can't happen. We're teaching you this for a reason. This is about just getting out and having a good time. That all was there. This is about being a professional, an absolute constant professional, being safe. And so with those two exceptions, yes. What you'll see in our agreement is we don't guarantee you a job. We guarantee you the jobs will always be there. You have to earn that. We guarantee you can train them at this level. It's your attitude is the only thing, your personal attitude is the only thing that stops you in this industry. And it's an amazing industry, it really is. It's a lot of fun. It's a huge passion. It's something that every day you get to do something different. Right? Kind of which way the wind's blowing, what the weather's doing, which helicopter you're flying, which career path you take, and you get to do something different. Now, when we hire you, we start our pilots off at $25 an hour. At $25 an hour, you must work 40 hours a week. That's $1,000 a week. That's $52,000 a year. You can work more than that. You must, by company policy, take one day a week off. We actually had to write a policy that says you have to take a day off. And people that won't go away. It's just something you just love to do and they want to be around it all the time. And you can move up to the industry. Now, I'm going to answer some of the questions that probably are going to come up anyway. One of them is, what can you really expect to make? If you look at the average pilot in our company that has less than 2 years experience, which means from the day they graduate and no more than 2 years, those average pilots last year were making $67,400 in the $60,000 range is what they were making. It's $20 an hour, but they're working extra time, and they're doing some other contract work, they're doing work besides just doing flight training. When did you move out of flight training? 500 hours is the minimum. When you hit 500 hours, you're going to be working 40 hours a week, you'll be flying 25 to 30 of those hours, and some of your work time is going to be spent pre-flight and post-flight helicopters. At 500 hours, you become eligible to do work outside of flight instruction, which would include, within our company, which includes agricultural work and these things. Mine controls, doing line controls, controlling railroad tracks, doing these types of things. We typically will not put you into a large helicopter with passengers until you get somewhere in the 1,000-hour range. You will meet some people that have done it sooner than that, but that's a very realistic number of 1,000 hours. Do the math on what that's going to take you. You get paid for every hour you work, not every hour you fly. Some companies only pay you by the Hobbs meter, So if you're not flying, you don't get paid. I think that's stupid. It's a safety hazard, because that makes you fly on days when you shouldn't be. If you show up to work at 8 o'clock in the morning and you go home at 5, and you work during those times, you've got something to do, you've scheduled, then you get paid during those times, even if you make the decision not to fly for one reason or another or couldn't, you're still going to get paid the same, and that's the way it should be. We have the 401k programs, we have the health insurance, and all of those great things that all the companies, the big companies have. And we've got a great work environment. We've got great equipment. All of our equipment, as you see, all these helicopters are new. We buy new equipment. We have 40 aircraft on order today from the factory, brand new. And we buy also the bells and things of the helicopters as fast as we can have hands on. And the company's growth is outrageous. Where's the company going? This year, acquisitions. What we're moving into right now, starting literally August of this year, is buying other companies. That's our goal. And we'll do very, very well at that. It gives us the ability to grow commercially as fast as we originally grew through our training programs, to keep up with our training programs and provide the jobs. Other companies' biggest weaknesses are our biggest strengths. Lack of pilots, we have that. Mechanics, we have that. Facilities, we have that. Insurance, we have that. Our insurance policy is one of the few in the world where you do not have to qualify for our insurance. The only qualification on our insurance says, if the owner of the company, or the chief pilot, or the director of operations says you can fly it, then you can fly it. You do not have to submit pilot logs and your pilot histories. It's our decision. And I'll tell you a real quick story about how I got to that, and I'm going to see if I can put you guys out here. When I met with the insurance company, they said, well, we want to see the pilot logs. We want to see these guys have 1,500 hours for this and 2,000 hours for that. I said, all right. If you were going to insure a jump, a stunt in Las Vegas, and you had Evel Knievel wanting to jump over the Bellagio, all the water towers, and you got this 16-year-old kid in Las Vegas that wants to jump over, and who would you insure? Evel Knievel. Been doing it for years. He can't land without crashing and breaking every bone in his body, or a whole lot of them. Yet this kid is doing jumps that are over 300 feet, coming off his motorcycle and waving at the crowd in the air and then landing with no hands every time. I'll take him if I'm going to insure somebody. And so the point I'm making is, don't tell me that because a guy's been doing it for a long time, he's good at it. When I'm flying with helicopter pilots and I got people working for me, I know who's good at it. You get in the helicopter within a matter of seconds, you know who's good at it. I should be the one making those decisions. My chief pilots, my operations guys should make those decisions. We proved it was the right thing to do. Several years now we've had that policy in place. It works. We've got a safety record that's unbeatable. What's the cost of this? Most of you already know that if you looked it up. We do the entire program for just under $70,000. 70, not 17. If you go out and try to compare that to the industry, you're running anywhere from $65,000 to $100,000+ for a typical CFI course, which is 150 hours of flight time. This is not a typical course. This is 200 hours of flight time, 30 of that in R-44, the rest of it in R-22, unlimited simulator time, unlimited ground training, unlimited classroom environment. It's a great program, and I'll tell you, nobody can compete with us in the price of it, and we made it affordable by saying you don't pay that until 6 months after you graduated the program, then you start your payback, and we set it up just like any other student loan, just like any college in America. So, with that, I'm going to answer a couple of questions from the rooms. I may have forgot something, and then after that, we'll just answer individuals. Any questions I can answer? Yeah. File flight plans. We have a company policy that we file a flight plan within our own company front, but we are not required to file a flight plan with the tower. No. You can just get your helicopter and go fly. So, but we fly them internally so we know where you're going all the time. We know what you're doing. Yeah.
Relocation, is that necessary?
Not necessary. Relocation, I'm glad you asked that. You are welcome to go to work for one of our other offices, and you'll get plenty of offers if you're willing to move. But we want you here. You're from here, and we want you working here, and we'll build a business around you right here. That's the beauty of all this. The only advantage to moving is that sometimes opportunities come up faster in another location because they're an older company, older office has already been there for a while. People will go there, and they'll spend 6 months or a year, and then come back here with those skill set. What I'll do, because of the time and Todd and Helen here, is anybody that has a Silver State shirt on should be able to answer your questions for you. I'm going to stay here in front of the stage, and I will individually, if you'd like to come up, I'd be more than happy to talk to you and answer your questions individually as well as the other people who work here, Kevin. I'm going to let you get out of this hot environment. If you'd like to fill out an application, they're in the back of the room. And